Open up God's Word. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, I thank you, God, for this wonderful opportunity that we have, Lord, to hear from you, from your Word. We just pray, Father, that you would just, open, Lord God, our ears, Lord God, to not only hear, but Lord, to be able to do, Lord God, what your Word says. And Lord God, open the eyes of our hearts so that we can understand. It's you that give us wisdom and understanding. We're asking you for your help, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Right now we're going to dismiss the children to go to their children's church and learn in a wonderful, fun environment for them. Amen. Well, as I was preparing for today, and as we're starting our 10-day fast, I wanted to talk about something. There's a reason why we do, why we prayerfully consider doing a fast, and it's because we want to get closer to God as a church. And fasting, as we're going to see in a moment from God's Word, helps us to do that. You know that intimacy is something that, whether you know it or not, you were made to experience. If you acknowledge it or not, you were made to experience intimacy. And God made us like him, and he made us with a desire to experience intimacy together. He included a strong desire for that. And there is, when we don't experience intimacy, we get damaged. As a matter of fact, if you study what the psychologist made some studies about this and found the very thing that when people are deprived of intimacy, either growing up or the mother-father relationship, they get damaged. And it's something when psychologists and scientists catch up to what God tries to tell us through his Word all along. Intimacy is a key to our well-being, and the greatest intimacy that we can ever experience is intimacy with our Creator, the God who made us. There's no potentially deeper relationship or intimacy that we can experience than the one that we can with God. And by the way, if we have that one right, if we're able to learn and have that breakthrough of how to be closer and intimate with our God, it will shape everything else about you, and it will shape every other relationship that you have in a positive way. First of all, let's get the matter settled that the only way to have intimacy with God comes through a relationship with Jesus Christ. How many say amen? Amen. John 14:6, a very well-known passage of Scripture that Jesus said. He said, I am, let's read it together, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. Do we have that straight? There's no other way. There's no other quote-unquote religion. Jesus didn't come to teach religion. Jesus came to teach a relationship. As a matter of fact, it was he that taught us even how to approach God. So I want to look at some surefire ways that we can cultivate intimacy with God. The title of this message is A Fast Track to Intimacy with God. And before you get excited about a shortcut, I'm talking about fasting, okay? There are some surefire ways that we can cultivate intimacy with God. Number one, obviously, fasting. I'm listing that first because we happen to be starting our church-wide fast today for 10 days, and I want to speak about the importance and the power of it. First of all, let's look at what fasting is not. Fasting is not to be done publicly. It's not, people shouldn't know that you're doing it. We're doing a church-wide fast, so we all know that we're doing. Hopefully many of you are joining us on this journey, but you're not supposed to look like you are. It's not intended as a punishment for your flesh. Fasting is not to punish yourself. It's not a dieting method. I've heard some people say, oh good, the church is going on a fast, I could use this to start, you know, one of my New Year's resolutions to lose weight. It's not a way to appear more spiritual. It's not for that. And by the way, it's not a way to get God to do what you want him to do. It's not for that either. But let's talk about what it is. And Scripture, I want to be clear, Scripture, God doesn't command us to fast. It's nowhere found that God that it's a commandment from God to fast. But it's clear that the Bible presents fasting as something that is good and profitable and beneficial. And not only that, Jesus took it for granted that we would fast. In Matthew chapter 6, part of his Sermon on the Mount, when he was teaching the disciples and the people, he, when teaching them how to fast, said this, "But when you fast," is it up there? Did we lose our thing up there? "But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face." He was teaching us. But notice he said, when. He didn't say if, did he? You got the wrong one up there? The first one. Matthew 6:17 says, "But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face." When you do it, not if you do it. And both the Old and the New Testament teach the value of fasting, which is abstaining from food or drink or something else that's relevant and important to us that takes our time in order to focus on prayer and on seeking God's will. It's something that should cost us something, that means something to us. If you're going to fast, if you're going to bother to do it, then it should be something that costs you something. I was sharing and making a joke in the back room that I've heard some people say they're going to fast some frivolous things. Like I could say, okay, for the next 10 days, I'm going to fast wearing brown shoes, although I'm wearing them today. What good would that do, right? That's not a big weight on me unless all my shoes were brown. But fasting, how many know fasting can be intimidating? As a matter of fact, I used to be very afraid of it. Why? I mean, obviously, I enjoy eating to a point if it's the right kind of food. But just like I was marveling yesterday, I just had a meal like maybe an hour or an hour and a half before, and I was starting to feel hungry already. And of course, I thought of, wow, tomorrow we start a 10-day fast. What am I going to do? Now, I've been through this before, and every time I'm going to start a fast, that's how your mind thinks, because you're thinking of in your own strength, in your own power. You're thinking that way. But as you begin to do what God prescribes, what he suggests, then God helps you. I just want to bring some points on what biblical fasting does. And by the way, if you want description of what kind of fast is, there's something in your bulletin today that I wrote that gives you a little idea of the different kind of things you could do as we start. Also, I want you to know that each day on our Facebook page and on our website, there's going to be a devotional during this fast every day to help you along. First of all, biblical fasting brings us into a closer union with God. While our bodies are being deprived of food or whatever it is for the purpose of drawing near to God, he promised that he would draw near to us. It's a spiritual certainty because when we decrease, the spirit increases. As individuals, we're renewed and we're strengthened. Fasting does this. It diminishes the physical and heightens the spiritual. That's what's going on in fasting, which is, by the way, what's necessary for intimacy with God. How many would like to get closer with God? I want to get closer with God. And here's our problem, our physical. When you're thinking physical, how is God? What does God says he is? What does God say that he is? God is what? He's spirit. And how must we worship him? In spirit and in truth. In other words, our spirit has to connect with God's spirit. Our physical or the physical world, the physical mind keeps us as like a barrier to get to God. When John the Baptist was speaking about the importance of Jesus compared to his importance, he said something which is a key to what happens in fasting. He said when his disciples were complaining that Jesus was getting important and John was getting less important, this is what John says in John 3:30. He said, he, meaning Jesus, must become greater and I must become less. And when you deny your physical body something, you become less. And if you do it right, he becomes more in you. And that's the goal that we have, in case you didn't know it. Less of you, more of him. How many know that that's our goal as Christians? The less of you there is, less of what? What does that mean? Less of your sinful nature. Less of your flesh, those things that pull us in the wrong way, the better for you. How many have learned that? How many have learned that your flesh is not your friend? How many have learned that your flesh will sell you out? It will take you the wrong way. It will cooperate with Satan to destroy your life. That's why, now think of that in terms of fasting, when you are lessening or weakening your flesh, your spirit has a chance to connect better with God. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16, this is not about fasting, but it also describes the process of what happens when we fast. 2 Corinthians 4:16 says, therefore we do not lose heart, though outwardly we are wasting away. When you fast and you don't eat, you start wasting away. How many notice that? You start getting bent over and hunched over a little bit. Though outwardly we're wasting away, yet inwardly we're being renewed day by day. And then it goes on, but it brings us to a closer union with God. You know, some of my closest times with God has been when my body has been the weakest. One time I was supposed to speak somewhere in Wisconsin, and the night before I had a horrible episode. I should have gone to the hospital. My wife was arguing with me to go to the hospital, but I had made a commitment in a church, and I decided to go anyway, not knowing how in the world I was even going to stand up. And I don't know if it was the wisest thing to do, but I went there, and you know what I was preaching on? That verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9, for when I am weak, then I'm strong, for his power is made perfect in weakness, right? That's what the word of God says. That's what I was preaching on. And I couldn't even stand. And I remember when, it was my turn to get up and speak, I felt like I was going to get literally sick. It was beyond just sick to my, it was just, I don't even want to describe to you. It was a long story. Anyway, when they called me up to speak, I got up. And all of a sudden, I'm going to just tell you, there were people there. My wife was there and other friends that came. The Holy Spirit just came on me. And my body straightened up. And I'll tell you the truth. I felt like that nothing was ever, ever wrong with me or with my body. And I was able to bring the message of God, which I myself was living at the moment. God made me live the words that were coming out of my mouth. When we lessen our spirit, our flesh, we can get, it's a wonderful opportunity to get closer to God. It will help us grow a more intimate relationship with him. This is why, listen to Galatians 5:17. This is the whole thing here. It helps you to be on the right side of the conflict. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the spirit, and the spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other so that you are not to do whatever you want. There's a war going on in us, and one side or the other is going to win. Your flesh wants its way. The spirit wants you to go the right way, and there's a war waging on. Whatever you feed will win the day. If you're feeding your flesh, I don't mean if you're eating food. I mean doing the things that our sinful nature craves and wants, then your sinful nature will drive you. If you're feeding your spirit, by the things that feed our spirit and getting closer to God, then the spirit will drive us. That's what I want. How many want that instead of a sinful flesh driving us? So what is it about our bodies? Your bodies and my body, God is using my body right now. He used the body of these brothers in Christ to bless us as they sang using their physical voice. Our bodies are awesome servants, but they're terrible masters. If your body is your master, you are in big trouble. Make it your servant. Make it a servant of the Lord, and then you're talking. Biblical fasting is also a means by which God grants supernatural revelation and wisdom. Do you want to know more about the things of God? You want to have more wisdom from God? There's a story in Luke chapter 2 when Joseph and Mary took the baby Jesus to the temple to have him dedicated. There was a lady there who was a widow. The Bible says that she spent day and night in the church and fasting and praying. And guess what? When Mary walked in with the baby, she immediately knew that that was the Messiah. How could she have known that? Because she was a woman who fasted and prayed, and God revealed to her. That's what God does. God wants to show us things, but we're not paying attention. And to help us, since we're all ADD when it comes to spirituality, everybody in this world has ADD spiritually. Everything else grabs our attention. So fasting helps us to focus so that God can download things that he wants to show us that other people aren't seeing. Fasting helps us to get a new perspective and a new reliance on God. Fasting is a surrender of the body, the soul, and the spirit to God. That's why it's so effective. Fasting brings a heightened sense of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is to be experienced. It's not just to be taught about. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of God, and he's alive, and he's active. Whoever said that he's not doesn't know what they're talking about, haven't read their word. He's alive. He's meant to be experienced. He's meant to be in your life, showing you, controlling you from doing the things that you shouldn't do. Biblical fasting takes your eyes off of the things of the world and puts them and refocuses them and redirects them to your attention to Christ. It also brings a focus that will heighten your communication and your prayers with God. It's like a turbo boost for your prayers. In the book of Ezra in chapter 8, the people of God were leaving their captivity in Babylon, led by Ezra the priest. And they were going to travel a long way back to Jerusalem. And this is what Ezra says in chapter 8, 21, and then verse 23. There by the Ahava Canal, I proclaimed a fast so that we might humble ourselves before our God and ask him for a safe journey for us and our children with all of our possessions. So we fasted and petitioned our God about this. And what's the next line say there? And he answered our prayers. Sometimes, we're wrestling with God and wrestling in asking him for something, not something frivolous, something that is necessary, and the answer seems to be delayed. Have you ever tried fasting about it, and fasting and coupling it with that petition that you have? The Bible tells us that we should. It heightens our communication with God. It helps when you're facing great challenges. How many of you have read the book of Esther when the people of God were about to get executed due to a terrible man named Naaman who was jealous of the Jewish people? And God had elevated a Jewish girl, a simple Jewish girl named Esther, and she became King Xerxes' wife, who was the king at that time. And Mordecai, her uncle, was appealing to Esther, go talk to the king and tell him what's going on. The problem was there was a law that if you went to the king and he didn't call you, you would die. You'd have to die. Unless he summoned you, you couldn't go see him. So she said, I can't go see him. And he says, well, do you think that God didn't put you there for a reason, for such a time as this, or are you just going to watch out for your own skin? That's my own vernacular. That's not how it says it exactly in the Bible. So this is what Esther decided to do in chapter 4 of Esther, verse 16. This is what she told the people. Go gather together all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my attendants will fast as you do. When this is done, I will go to the king, even though it's against the law. And if I perish, I perish. And who knows the rest of the story? She did not perish. The king extended his scepter, God intervened, and the people of God were saved. Amen? Fasting will give you a fresh determination to serve God. If you're waning in your desire to serve God, try fasting. It'll help you, give you a new determination to serve Him. It helps to get direction from God. It was during fasting and praying in Acts chapter 13 that they knew, that the disciples knew to send Paul and Barnabas out to the Gentiles. It was during a fast and prayer that God, it says the Holy Spirit directed them to send Paul and Barnabas. How do we do things now in modern church era? We vote on it, or we just decide we're going to do something. Nobody checks on God. We do it by committee. What do we need God for? How many in favor? Say aye. Meanwhile, if we do it the right way, God means to show us what we should do, when we should do it, and how we should do it. We don't have to figure this out by ourselves. God has a divine plan, and I want in on it. How many want in on God's divine plan? It's so much better than ours. You know why? He never fails. His always work out. I've figured out that mine rarely do when I go my own way. Fasting will also be beneficial when you're making important decisions. It was the same Paul and Barnabas who were choosing and selecting elders for the churches there in the book of Acts chapter 14. And it says as they were praying and fasting, they chose them and committed them to the Lord. If you need a personal revival, fasting will help in that regard. If you're facing a strong spiritual battle, how many know we're in a war? We're facing spiritual warfare. This is no joke. How many know that? If you don't know that, you better know that. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 6 that we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and forces in this dark world. And there was a story in Matthew chapter 17 where a father brought a son who was possessed and having seizures and acting like a lunatic. If you read the King James and New King James, it says he was a lunatic. And they went to the disciples, and the disciples could not cast this, cannot help this boy, even though they had cast out demons out of other people. So they called Jesus, and Jesus cast him out. And then later on, the disciples asked him, well, why couldn't we do it? We did it before with others. How come we couldn't do this one? And he said, however, this kind does not go out except by prayer and by fasting. There are certain spiritual battles that you need some extra oomph, and fasting supplies that extra oomph. It's important when you're facing great opposition. King Jehoshaphat was facing the entire Moabite and Ammonite army, an army so vast they couldn't even be counted. They were going to be annihilated, and he called a countrywide fast. He proclaimed a fast for all of Judah, and of course, God delivered them. When you're in trouble and you don't know what to do, how many of you have ever been in trouble and don't know what to do? Raise your hand if you've ever been there. How many are there right now? There are some things going on in our lives as a family that I don't know what to do. Listen to Nehemiah, because he tells us and shows us what to do. Nehemiah chapter 1, verse 4. When I heard these things, Nehemiah had heard about the destruction of Jerusalem and about the condition of it. The wall was in shambles, and the condition of the town was in shambles. This is what he said. When I heard these things, I sat down and wept. For some days I mourned and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. And if you read the rest of the story, God gave him exactly what to do, and even how to face the opposition that he was about to face. How many say amen? And finally, fasting will help us to have and maintain spiritual strength until Jesus comes back. You know, when John the Baptist was here, he had disciples. And one time, the disciples, John's disciples, noticed that the disciples of Jesus didn't fast like they did. And so they went, approached Jesus, and in Matthew chapter 9, we read this. Then John's disciples came and asked him, "How is it that we and the Pharisees fast often, but your disciples do not fast?" Jesus answered, "How can the guests of the bridegroom mourn while he is with them?" And then listen to the next sentence. "The time will come when the bridegroom will be taken away from them, then they will fast." If you haven't noticed, the bridegroom has been taken away. He's in heaven at the right hand of God. He also lives in our heart. So it's time to fast. Jesus was teaching his disciples that after his departure, the entire dynamic of what they were used to was going to change, and they would have to need a different type of preparation and provision. And fasting was a vital part of that preparation. So obviously, it's all through Scripture, from the Old Testament to the New Testament. All different kind of stories of people who were in trouble, people that needed God, people that were in mourning, people that wanted to get closer to God. They fasted and God heard and answered them. So that's one of the things that we have to do to get on the track for intimacy with God. The second thing is prayer. Prayer. It might sound obvious, but let me just say this. Fasting without prayer is completely useless. I know people who fast and do all kinds of things except pray. I've met people who were fasting and living in sin at the same time. And my counsel to those people is, go out to the nicest restaurant you can find. Have yourself a meal. Have it your way. Go to Burger King or something. But don't waste your time not eating. That doesn't mean anything. The reason you fast is so that you can connect with God. How do you connect with God? You pray, don't you? There was a man named Oswald Smith. He was an influential Canadian pastor and evangelist who said this: when we work, we work. When we pray, God works. We've become good at working. Christian churches have become organizations that we can have the power to do things in our own strength. When we work, we work. But to see God work, you see, God, when God works, you cannot explain it. When God works, it's not, oh, he did something a little nice. When God does something, he leaves you with your mouth wide open, and it's obvious that his fingerprints were all over it. For example, yes, let's give the Lord a hand clap offering. For example, when he parted the Red Sea, was there any doubt of what happened there? Was there anybody else that can do that? We probably would have thought this, well, let's build a bridge. Right? But, of course, there would be no fire of God to stop the Egyptian army while you built that bridge, right? See, God has an incredible, amazing, miraculous, supernatural way of doing things when we cannot do it ourselves. And sometimes when we can do it ourselves, we do, don't we? There are things that we can do, obviously, not a scintilla as much as God can do, but we will do it our way because that's the easiest thing we think for us to do. When God wants to do something so much more, but we can't do it without prayer. It's rightly said that the secret of all failure is our failure in secret prayer. Many Christians suffer from a lack of prayer. And without prayer, let me just say that there's no possible way that you will ever experience intimacy with God. Jesus taught us how to pray when we pray. And I'm not talking about the Lord's Prayer. He taught that as well. But in Matthew chapter 6, verse 6, he says this: "But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. I want to bring out a couple of points there. First of all, Jesus was the one that taught us that God, not only is He God Almighty, not only is He the Lord of all the earth, not only is He our Creator, not only is He awesome God, He's also our Abba Father. He was the one who taught the disciples to pray our Father. They had not heard that before. And when you go to your Father, there's intimacy into a secret place, just you and Him. There's intimacy. That's what He was teaching us. Many Christians don't pray. They say they're too busy. You don't know my schedule. I have to get up early, and I get home kind of late. I remember one time the boys were in a baptism class. It was 6 weeks long, and on the sixth one, they invited the parents. They used to invite the parents to come so that we can see everything that the kids had learned. And I was just there as a parent with my wife. And when we heard what they had taught them, we were very pleased. And then they were teaching the kids, which I was thrilled about, that they should have their own quiet time with God. I thought that was awesome. And that we should lead them as parents in prayer. So then one parent stood up, and then another parent stood up, and their thing is, well, we're too busy to do that. You know, I get home late. They started making all these excuses, and I was sitting there. I was like, you know, I was getting upset. So I stood up. I said, wait a minute. How about if you don't watch that sitcom at night when you get home and teach your and pray with your child? How about that? You tell me you don't have 10 minutes of your day to teach your child how to pray or to pray with them or lead them in a devotional? Tell me who here doesn't have 10 minutes, please. Who doesn't have 10 minutes? Hello. You know what? If we don't invest, then when the child grows up and goes off somewhere, and then we go, oh, what happened? Oh, how come? Well, what are you investing in? What are you wasting time on? Can I be honest with you here? What's important to us? This is life and death. Listen to how busy Jesus was. Listen to this, Mark chapter 1. Tell me if you're as busy as this. Starting in verse 32. That evening, after sunset, the people brought to Jesus all the sick and demon-possessed. The whole town gathered at the door. Imagine if the whole town was at your door wanting you. And Jesus healed many who had various diseases. He also drove out many demons, but He would not let the demons speak because they knew who He was. And then verse 35 says this, very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where He prayed. After that whole commotion, you and I would have taken a siesta. Well, God knows I was working for Him last night. I don't have to get up early today. It says while it was still dark, He got up early to go to a place alone where He prayed. And then after that, it says Simon and his companions went to look for Him. And when they found Him, they exclaimed, everyone is looking for you. That was the life of Jesus. But He always found a way. He would go up into that mountain, and He would spend time alone with God. My question for us is this. You know what? I had to realize this in my life because I used to be lacking in prayer. And of course, I was lacking in strength, and I was lacking in power, and I was lacking in a good testimony. And I didn't know why. Duh. If the Lord Jesus, who is our model, because He had taken on flesh, needed that connection with the Father, what makes me think that I can just go on day after day in my own strength and think I'm going to make it? Why are you looking at me like that? Am I right? How many say amen? How many agree about that? It's a wake-up call for us. Amen? And when the disciples saw how differently, how intimately Jesus prayed, because sometimes they were with Him when He prayed. Jesus prayed all the time. And He revealed God as the Father. The disciples desired to pray like He did in Luke 11:1. They asked Him. Once Jesus was in a certain place praying, and as He finished, one of His disciples came to Him and said, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples. In other words, he was saying, hey, I wanna learn how to pray like that. How do I pray like that? Because praying without intimacy, to be honest, is boring. You'll fall asleep while you pray. I used to fall asleep praying. Anybody here ever fall asleep praying? Am I the only one guilty of that? Let me tell you something. When you are in an active, intimate conversation with someone, you will not fall asleep. If you are engaged in the conversation and it's alive to you, you will be excited about praying. Let me give you a couple of examples of intimacy with God through prayer. In Psalm 63, 1-3, this is David, a wonderful model for us. You, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you. In a dry and parched land where there is no water, I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. There's a man that was excited about speaking to his God, and he didn't even have the benefit of knowing that Jesus was coming and that Jesus was going to forgive all of his sins. His sins were forgiven because the power of the blood is so perfect that it forgives sins past, present, and future. How many say amen and know that's true? Psalm 84, 1 and 2. How lovely is your dwelling place, Lord Almighty. My soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of my Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. Does your heart and your flesh cry out for the living God, or is he ho-hum to you? Can you take it or leave it? If you don't pray, would you even notice that you were missing prayer? Prayer is intimate, and fasting and prayer is intimate and powerful. I don't know about you, but I want more from God. I am not done. I'm just getting started. I want to hear from God. I want direction from God. I want power from God. I want an anointing from God. I want direction from God. I want to know what's going to happen. I want to be in on God's plans. Are you guys with me? Raise your hand if you want the same thing. Let's give a clap to the Lord Almighty. So fasting and prayer coupled together. And the final thing I'm going to speak about, it's not the only thing for intimacy, but there's the three that I'm speaking about today. Worship. Intimacy is nourished by worship. It is so important. That's why we spend a good amount of time. It's on purpose that we spend. We don't know how much time we're going to sing. We sing until we're feeling that, okay, we got all the juice out of this one, and God is moving us on to the next one. We don't have a set time. We don't put God on a time clock because it's important to spend time in worship and adoration. If we spent the rest of eternity worshiping him, it would not be enough. So why are we in a hurry to move on to our little service? Hello. Hey, I got a bulletin here. It tells me what's going to happen next. You know, I've been in places where they have the bulletin, and they tell you how many minutes each thing is going to last. Introduction, 1 minute. Prayer, 1 minute. Worship, 15 minutes. Announcements, 20 minutes. You're right. You got a lot to tell you in announcements. The sermon, so-and-so minutes. Benediction, so-and-so minutes. Total time of service, 61 minutes and 30 seconds. I was with a group in one church, and it was a church supposedly back in the day, this denomination, it was a denominational church. They were known for some pretty up meetings. So I'm thinking, oh, wow, we're going to have a little freedom here. We got there, and the pastor told us, you have 1 hour and 5 minutes. We were going to sing and bring a word. The church that I was from, we used to travel. He said, if you don't finish in 1 hour and 5 minutes, the people will walk out in the middle of whatever you're doing. And we said, lovely church you have there. We did not say that. We were just like, oh, my goodness. So obviously, whatever we were going to do, we honored what the pastor was saying, but what a shame. My question to you is, where are you going? Where are you going? You mean you can sit for 3.5 hours watching a football game that doesn't matter a hill of beans, and you can't spend 1.5 hours in the church of God? If you go 1.10 hours, you're walking out because you got to go and do what?
Watch the game.
Right, yeah. Right, and after you watch the game and your wife gets angry at you and you're not talking, then what? And they lost again. Your team did. And you're just going to be mad all day. All day. And you might kick a hole in your TV and then have to purchase another TV. Listen to what A.W. Tozer said that worship was. He was a noted evangelical pastor. He wrote one of the best books a classic called The Pursuit of God. And then he has another one that's not so good. If you want to read a good book, God's Pursuit of Man. Oh, forget about our pursuit of God. God pursues us. Read it and be blessed. Anyway, this is what he said that worship is. Worship is to feel in your heart and express in some appropriate manner a humbling but delightful sense of admiring awe and astonished wonder and overpowering love in the presence of that most ancient mystery, that majesty which philosophers call the first cause, but which we call our Father, which art in heaven. A humbling, delightful sense of admiring awe and astonished wonder and overpowering love in the presence of our Father, which art in heaven. Do you experience worship that way? If you don't, then you're lacking intimacy with God, because that's exactly how it is when you're worshiping God in spirit and in truth. When you're worshiping with God, God is communicating his presence to you and me. And a transformation happens when you learn to come into the presence of God and to worship him. Not to ask him for anything. Simply to be satisfied and to be occupied with him. That's what worship is. The base of worship is not you like the song, you like that style, I like Southern gospel, I like black gospel, I like this, I like that, oh, that doesn't have enough juice in it. Worship is to lift up and join with all creation and all of the angels and the 24 elders who are bound before the throne right now, singing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." There's a strength, there's a power that's going on right now that you connect to when you connect and engage with God in worship. It's an active, it's an alive thing. It's not a performance of a bunch of people singing and playing their instruments here and hopping around a stage like they were the Energizer Bunny or something. Listen to worship. Psalm 28:7, "The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him and he helps me. My heart leaps for joy and my song, and with my song I praise him." Listen, if you don't worship, then you'll never experience worship. You have to join in. You know, sometimes it takes a little while. Like I told you, we have ADD spiritually. Sometimes you got to sing a song a little bit. That's why you have a chance here. If you come in and you're all distracted, you have a chance to get it before we're done with the first song. And then you're ready for the second one. How many of that happens to you? It takes you a little while. You might have sung it 6 times through and didn't even know what you were singing or where you were or what your name was. Right? You're just doing it because, hey, we've done church. We know how to do this, you know. Lord Jesus paid it all. Oh, to him I owe. Sin has lost its crimson stain. I gotta pay that bill. Did I leave food for the dog? He washed it all away. Then you sing it a second time, you think about something else, and the third time. And the fourth time, the words hit you. Jesus paid it all. He paid it all. All to him I owe. Oh God, I do owe you everything. Sin has left its crimson stain, but he washed it all away. Oh, now we're singing it again. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Doesn't it take us a while? Right? But when we connect, oh my goodness, is it glorious or what? Listen to Psalm 86, 12 and 13. With all my heart I will praise you, O Lord my God. I will give you glory to your name forever. For your love for me is very great. You have rescued me from the depths of death. And Psalm 84, 1 and 2, how lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of heaven's armies. I long, yes, I faint with longing to enter the courts of the Lord with my whole being, body, and soul. I shout joyfully to the living God. Listen, we all need and crave intimacy. That's how we were created. But the greatest need for intimacy that we have is intimacy with God. And Jesus paved the way open for us to be able to experience it. Your soul and your spirit, my soul and my spirit, will find rest and intimacy with God alone. From there, you can enjoy intimacy everywhere else. You want to have intimate relationships. You want to have a better relationship with your spouse, with your children, with your friends, with important relationships. Be intimate with God. Even those difficult relationships, God will help you because you'll be alive in you. It's just a different thing. Fasting and praying and learning how to be a worshiper will drive you into a deeper relationship with Jesus ever more in this new year. If you came today, you knew we were fasting, you weren't planning to, maybe you'll change your mind. It's a very, very private thing. But the reason we're doing it is not just to do it. We didn't hear that they're doing it in Florida or in Kentucky, and so we're doing it too. God has called us to fast and seek Him. You know why? Because I want us to experience the true and the living God. I want us not to stay the same. There's some people been going to church 10, 15 years. They haven't moved or budged an inch. They don't know God better now than they did 15 years ago. And in part, sometimes that's our fault because we don't lead further. I don't want to make that mistake. I'm going to go for everything that I can get. You know why? Let me be honest with you, it's because I need it. I need Him. I'm at a point in my life, I've lived more years than I have left, and I want to go out with a bang. And going out with a bang means getting to know Jesus as close as I can. I'm already overwhelmed, I got to tell you. I'm already overwhelmed at His mercy, His grace, His love for me. I can't get over it. But you see, I know I'm just scratching the surface. There's a lot more for each and every one of us. For you men that sing, you blessed us. But you know what? There's more for you. There's a powerful anointing that would come upon you whenever you sing, that it would take people into, you know, you go into some needy places. Imagine going deeper. Not that you don't bless, you do. You're a blessing. But you know there's more? There's more. Can I speak into your life? Do you mind? Be used of God. I'll speak to you afterwards, brother. But my heart is for God to use you like never before. And for all of us, whatever it is that we're doing, God has direction for us. Specific. It's not random. He has a plan for each one of our lives. But if we don't seek, if we don't knock, if we don't ask, then we're not going to get anywhere. Let's not do that and wonder, what happened? How come? Hey, how many are ready to go for all it's worth? Amen? If we're going to do this, let's do this. Amen? We're going to be here praying Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. Thursday, we're going to pray for individual needs. Be here and seek God with us. In the meantime, you know, fast something. There's a lot of ways to fast. Fast something that means something. And then use the time that you would have done that thing to pray and ask God. I guarantee you that you will not be spinning your wheels. I guarantee you you'll go deeper with God. I'm guaranteeing you that God will speak to your heart. I'm guaranteeing you that if you were stuck, you will get unstuck. I'm guaranteeing you that if you weren't feeling God, God will show up. There's no way that you will seek Him and He will not be found. That's His promise. That's what we've experienced. That's what you will experience. Amen? Would you bow your heads with me? If you're here today and you've never made a solid relationship with Jesus, you've never received Jesus into your heart, and today God is speaking to your heart. I don't know who you are, but if God is speaking to your heart and you want to take care of that today and accept the Lord Jesus as your Lord and Savior, raise your hand. I want to pray with you so that you can begin your relationship with Christ Jesus right now. Anybody here who want to make that decision before we go on? Amen. For all the rest of us, if you're here and you're like me, you're not satisfied with the status quo. You want more. I want you to stand to your feet. You want more. Let's sing that together. Worship the Lord right now. Let's acknowledge what He's done for us.
Jesus paid it all. All to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Jesus paid it all to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Oh, praise the
desire, God, by the act of standing up, Lord God, we're saying, Lord, that we want more from you. We want to draw closer to you. Your word is so encouraging. It says that, Lord, if we draw near to you, you will draw near to us, oh God, so we don't have to wonder if you will, oh Lord God. And Lord, we're coming today, oh God, and I'm praying, Father, for supernatural experiences, oh God. I'm praying, Lord God, that you would draw us so close to you, Father, that it would take our breath away, oh Lord God. I pray, Lord, that you would show us new things, oh God, and give us the direction, oh God, that we crave and that we need, oh Lord God. Lord, that we would know, God, your very presence, oh God, in our lives as we go to our secret place, Lord God, as we, Lord God, push aside, oh God, those things that we usually feed ourselves, oh Lord God. Lord, so that we can concentrate on our relationship with you, Father. Strengthen your people, oh Lord God, to follow through and seek you, Lord God, with all of our heart, all of our soul, all of our mind, all of our strength, oh God, and do those supernatural things in us, oh God, that are so necessary, God, as we walk this walk on this side of eternity, Lord Jesus. Lord, we expect great things because we serve a great God. Thank you, Father, for this journey that we're on. I know that we're not going to be disappointed. We love you, Lord. We praise you. We glorify your name. We bless your name. Would you begin to thank him right now for what he's about to do? Hallelujah. We thank you. We praise you. We glorify you, oh God. Thank you for your word, oh God. Let your power and your spirit descend on your people and have your way, Father. Bring us from glory to glory to glory, Lord Jesus, we pray. God, we ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I think the Lord deserves one more hand.